Thinking is easy, but working hard on a regular basis is challenging. But remember that nothing is impossible and you can do this. And this video, I'm going to help you out to crack your NEET PG to make your dream come true. Hello friends, this is Dr. Sangeeta and welcome back to another lecture of Dental Paathshala, where we help you understand and learn dentistry better and easy way. And this video is a little effort to help you prepare for your NEET PG exam. Subscribe and join me in your beautiful challenging journey to crack NEET PG. So without further ado, let's get started. My lovely students, this video is a continuation of our previous lecture of gingiva, and today's lecture we are going to cover the gingiva. So what we have studied till now, we have studied that first of all, let's make the previous diagram. This is the structure of the tooth. Now I'm using this sketch pens today. I know that it may be risky because if we cannot rub off, then it's dangerous for us. So this part is the enamel, right? Here is the cementum. Then we have got here, what have we studied till now? It is very important. See, this diagram is very important for us to always remember in the perio. So we have to always start with this diagram. So this is basically our gingiva, right? Then here we have what? Here we have the free gingival groove, which is present in 50% of the cases. Now this particular part is our sulcus. So if you look at the sulcus, this is a V shape, right? See, look at this. It is a V shape. So always we see that gingival sulcus is V in shape. And what we have studied till now, last video, what we have studied? Last lecture, we have studied that the histological depth of the gingival sulcus is 1.8 millimeters. This is the histological depth. Clinical depth is when we insert the probe and when we check, it is 2 to 3 millimeters. Actually, it is 2 to 3 millimeters. But what happens? 2 to 3. Again, why I am writing 4? Because after 4, if there is a pocket, if there is a depth of more than 4, then we call it the pocket. So, more than 4 millimeter is the pocket. So, in that case, we have to do the procedures for the pocket reduction procedures. Then we have got 2 to 3, which is the normal clinical. And we have studied in the last lecture that another one is the histological depth. What is the histological? Once we cut the tooth, take out the tooth, then it is 1.8 millimeters. Right? So, this is the histological. Histo. So, this is the sulcus depth. Sulcular depth. This we have studied in the last video. Also, what else we have studied? See, this part is straight. This is the sulcular epithelium or the sulcular gingiva. So, what we have studied that this is straight. And next we have got, see, the free gingiva is straight. After that, there are red apex, I told you, in the marginal gingiva, right? So, in the marginal gingiva, this is MG, marginal gingiva. From the free gingival groove up to our mucogingival junction. This also we have studied in the last video. And because of this reason, because of the red apex, we see stippling. Stippling is what? See, this is a microscopic level. This gingiva, we don't see it as it is. We are just cutting the tooth and look at it from the inside view. So, if there are depressions, holes from inside, so outside we see little bit of, you know, protuberances and like that. A little bit of slightly microscopic structure is slightly wavy. So, that is why we see that there is a stippling which we see in case of marginal gingiva. That is because of these red apex, okay. So, that we have studied in the last video also. This is the attached gingiva. Why did I write marginal? This is attached gingiva. So, this part is attached. Attached gingiva is what? The part of gingiva which is attached to the bone is our attached gingiva. Then here we have the alveolar crest. Now, right. Also, we have studied one more thing, which is the junctional epithelium in the last video. So, junctional epithelium, what did we study? That it can start either from the CEJ, which is the cemento-enamel junction, or it can also start from the 1 millimeter above the CEJ, right? But it is straight, so there is also again no rate apex in case of our junctional epithelium. So this part is the junctional epithelium. Then the part which is surrounding the tooth like a collar, right, is our marginal gingiva. So you all must have wear a shirt, right? So like how a collar of a shirt is there, no, surrounding the tooth. So like that we have got the marginal gingiva which surrounds the tooth. This is the marginal gingiva, or you can say the free gingiva, right? So this is the marginal gingiva or the free gingiva. Then we have got what we have studied in is the width of the attached gingiva. So we have studied that the width of attached gingiva. This is last lecture which we are revising it, because these values are important. So it is important that we keep on revising it so that we keep on remembering it. So width of attached gingiva, we have studied that maximum where it is, minimum where it is. Maximum, you remember, it was up to 4.5. So maximum, I don't know what happened to me, why I'm writing everything wrong. So maximum it is in the maxillary incisor and in the mandibular incisor. That is basically the incisor area. Minimum it is in the premolar area. So again, premolar, in the premolar, maxillary and mandibular we are going to talk, right? So this is the maximum, this is the minimum. Maximum is there in the maxillary incisor, which is 3.5 to 4.5 millimeters. So that is more than 4.5. Now mandibular, it is little bit less than 4, right? If you remember, so 3.3 to 3.9 millimeter. For premolar, we have to cut down the mandibular incisor to half. So it was somewhere around 4. We have to cut down to 2. So it is going to be, because this was less, little bit less than 4. So we are going to take little bit less than 2. So that is going to be maxillary 1.9 millimeter. And mandibular, I don't know what happened to me today. And mandibular is 1.8 millimeters. So this is what we have finished in the last video. Also, we have finished that interdental gingiva, which is pyramid in shape in the anterior region. And posteriorly, it is oval in shape like a tent. So if you can see, it is like a pyramid here and it is like a tent. So for posterior, and the coal is again non-keratinized. This is what we have studied in the last video. So also we have studied about the biological width and junctional epithelium. So let's talk about today's lecture. We are going to talk about the cells, rest of the parts. We are going to talk about the cells, epithelium, so all the layers. So we are going to talk about all the layers of gingiva. So if you haven't watched our video, which I have released for the, that is actually pretty long video, but it covers all of the Carranza. So what happens? We have got the basal layer. See, these basal layer are, most of the times they are these cuboidal in shape. Okay. In the base, we have got the keratinocytes. And in the diseases of skin, we have already covered so many times the epithelial layer, so many times, right? So this is the basal layer. Basal layer, we have got the keratinocytes. Keratin, if anywhere the epithelium keratin is present, that means the basal layer always, see, you have to imagine it like a war zone, okay? So what happens? Initially, suppose I have to rub this. Now understand this concept, then you will never forget it. Suppose this is a particular area, okay? We call it the epithelial island. So what happens in this island? We have to protect this island. Inside there are people. This is a city. Inside there is a city. Periphery, we have to protect it so that no invader can come inside. Right? So we have got here some people at the post. We have got post, right? Everywhere, if you see, in every city, everywhere you will see there are police post, right? So police post at certain areas. So every boundary we have got these police post. So this is the basal layer. So we are talking about from the base. So the basal layer, these are the stations. You can say these are the training stations, these are the police stations, or whatever you like to say. So basically they are going to control, they are going to take people from the city and then put it in the army. So up above layer we have got some people, you know, again, these people are, now, these are the base layer, these are small, they do not have that much of, you know, strength and that much of potential. So that is why they are kept for at the desk job. So they are kept at the desk job that you are going to just hire the people and put it under the training procedure. So up above that, we have got some people who are not that strength, who do not have that much of strength, that much of potential, that much of good physique, because we want that good physique from at the outside of the border, right? So these people, they have got sword with them. They have got sword with them. Okay. All of them. Like sword, you all know, right? Sword. We use it to fight. Sword. So like old times, the king used to use for their fight purpose. So I'm not going to make it whole. So what happens once you go at the border? So you will see that there are, you know, next layer is very healthy people, very potential. They have got big, huge muscles and they work out. They are so fit. They are so excellent. So these people who are big, fit, excellent, right? So like these big one. So this is that people who are going to actually do the all of the protection work. I'm not going to make it whole. So let's just see. Right. So what happens? See, this is the only time we are going to discuss epithelium in detail. Now in the upcoming videos, we are not going to every time read about the epithelium. Okay. So we are talking about the keratinized epithelium here. So it implies to all of the skin, all of the areas wherein we have keratin. So these people, they have got, they are most qualified, you know, they are most trained. So they have got guns with them. Okay. Then what happens? By the time we prepare this whole army, we do not have more people. And the area here is very big to cover. So what we do? So we take all these people, you know, who are not that fit, who are, you know, very weak, and we just want to show other people that we have got a huge army and you cannot come inside. So for the protection purpose, we are taking these people, but these people are lying down, kind of dead, or you can say they are vampires. So they are kind of a dead people, okay? So they are lying down because we do not have that much of people that, see, if these people are standing, then we need more number of people, right, for protection. See, as you can see, this particular area, we have got less number of people, more number of people in less area. This particular area require less number of people in the more area. So we are asking these people to lie down. Now here comes the story. Now the layer which is the outer layer. So what is this? The layer which is at the basal layer, base level are the people who are doing the desk job, who are taking people from the city. So whoever people who are dying at the border, like normally also these are about to die, right? So these are the very old age, you can say. So whoever keep on dying, these basal city cells, these basal cells, these basal people who are hiring from the city, they are going to take people from the city and send it up. But they have to go through all these stages, right? So this is what the basal layer does. The basal layer, they are going to take up. So upper layer, it keep on shedding, like our dandruff. Then we have got layers of the skin. So like that, we have got the upper layer keep on shedding. And from the base, from city is the connective tissue, okay? So from the base, there is the basal cells, they keep on proliferating. So the most potential for the proliferation, most potential for the metabolism have the power of the basal layers, right? And in between, the granulomatosum, now the one with the spines are the spinosum layer. Easy to remember, easy peasy. So now we know that these people are holding the swords. If you look from the above, So if anyone want to put a nuclear weapon on our this particular island or this particular territory, so they will just go at the Google Maps. They will have this view from the maps, right? From above, they just look like the spines are there. So that is why spinosum layer. And because these army people, what they do, they wear these clothes which camouflage the environment, right? So next one is the gun with the gunman. So we have got the granulosum layer, above which we have got the corneum layer. Now I hope that you know all of the layer in the sequence. What happens when the bacteria invades? So in between here, there are powerful weapons which we have kept. Okay, here we have got some powerful weapons which we have kept. So these people, you know, they just be here, and what they do is whenever they see that any intruder is there. Suppose if anyone is coming from suppose if we are talking about in India, suppose this is the India territory, if anyone is coming from Pakistan and you know they pretend to be Indian, then what these cells does is they just going to grab it, analyze all of the thing, if everything is going normal, if they suspect anything, they are going to grab that person and wave the other people, wave the army people and tell that he is an intruder, right? So like that, if suppose this territory is the Pakistan, then they tell the army, then they tell that this guy is the Indian and he is invaded into the territory. So like that, this is an example. Okay, so what is this cell? So let's not draw this cell in the blue because otherwise you cannot see it. So this is, I'm going to make it in the red. So this particular cell is going to grab the enemy and wave it and tell it to the other army people that this is the intruder which has come. So this particular cell is our Langerhans cell or Langerhans cells, whatever you want to call it. Okay, these cells are going to grab the antigen. These cells are going to grab the antigen. Antigen is what is the foreign substance. Okay, so they are going to grab the antigen and wave it, present it on the surface. So they have got antigen presenting sites. They have got MHC, major histocompatibility class. This everything, if you are getting scared, do not get scared at all. One by one, we are going to cover in the physiology, in the pathology, we are going to cover each and everything. So right now, focus on what I'm telling you is that they are going to wave it. Okay, they are going to wave. They present it on the cell and they tell, oh, I have the enemy, I have the intruder, and they wave it. Then when they wave it, then we have got the T lymphocytes coming up. Then these T lymphocytes, this is all of the process what happens, I'm telling you. Then what happens, they wave it, then the T lymphocyte come, then the T lymphocyte, they are going to give alarm to the B lymphocyte. So the B lymphocyte, they are going to get all of the army. So a lot of B lymphocyte come and they are going to release some acid which we call the cytokines. The cytokines are going to damage the bacteria, as well as because this is acid. So what happens when you throw acid in somewhere? So also they kill the bacteria, but if this acid is in the normal tissues, it is going to burn the normal tissue. Like that, these cytokines are going to damage our body also. This is the whole process. I've told you the whole science which is involved now. So anything is impaired. Now you know the function of the Langerhans cells or Langerhans cells. Right? So what is the purpose of these keratin? See, so most of the students, they get confused between the keratin and the melanin. So in the basement membrane, in the basal layer, we have got two kind of cells. One are the keratinocytes, other are the melanocytes. So I'm going to make these cells from the sketch pen. Okay, I don't know if we'll be able to rub it or not. If you can see, I hope that you guys can see. See, these are the keratinocytes. Now keratinocytes are actually, keratin is used for the protection. Melanin is the pigment which gives the color. Okay, keratin gives white color, melanin gives darker shade. So all those who are like we people are, like Asian, we have got some melanin pigment, so we have little bit wheatish shade. Then if we go to African part, then they have got little bit darker shade of their skin. And this skin shade, darker color, is due to the melanin pigment, not due to the keratin pigment. So not due to the keratin. So the purpose of keratin is to do the protection. The melanin actually also does the protection on the skin. So if you have heard of these white people, what they do is they get the pigmentation done. If you have watched the Friend series, so in the one episode he went for the tanning procedure, right? Ross went for the tanning procedure and he just kept on tanning on one side, and what happens, he forgot, always he was late to turn, and then he tanned a lot of shades. So what the tanning does is, it is the melanin. So melanin purpose is, when the UV radiation falls on my skin, suppose the UV radiation has got the low wavelength. Now what happens when it has got the low wavelength? It is going to penetrate into the tissue. So the when it is going to penetrate into the tissue, now this, what it does, it is going to go inside the cell. Inside the cell, in the nucleus, we have got the DNA. So it is going to directly hit on the DNA and damage the DNA. But our body has got a repair mechanism. Now also we are going to study what happens in case of few diseases. This repair mechanism in case of, let me tell you only. Have you seen these people with the xeroderma pigmentosum? So these xeroderma pigmentosum, they have got pigments in the body. Like what happens when the X-ray UV radiation fall on their skin, reach up to the DNA. So there is a repair process actually which happens inside our body. The repair process is not happening for these people. So this is why, this is the importance of keratin. Keratin, if you see all of the oral pathology, also all of the diseases, all of the carcinoma wherein the keratinocytes are involved. So there is going to be the clinically lesion white in color. For example, papillomatous lesion. So oral papillomas, these are white in color because the keratinocytes are involved. Now I hope that you know the difference between keratinocyte and melanocytes. So now how does this melanocyte look like? So we have got also melanocytes also present. So these two cells we have already studied lot of times. More than 10 times we have studied that cell to cell adhesion is due to desmosomes, right? We know that cell to cell adhesion is, these both the cells are holding each other hand, and these cells are holding each other hand, we call it this connection, we call it desmosomes, right? And what happens when this cell is holding up to the, see, this is a basement membrane, okay? When the cell is holding up to the basement membrane tightly, so that it is connected to the epithelium, is connected to the connective tissue. So this particular connection we call it hemidesmosome. Now the difficulty part here is that we keep on forgetting that what is hemidesmosome, what is desmosome, which one is it? We get confused most of the time. So always remember, hemi means half. So we are going, see, half means desmosome, we have two cells. If we cut down one cell, then this is a hemidesmosome. So that means it is a membrane, not a cell. Right. So let's come to the melanocyte. So melanocyte is the, see, this is the connection. Okay. So remember my hand, always I show you my hand for the desmosomal connection. So this particular cell is without the thumb. So I'm going to draw a structure like my hand without a thumb. Okay. So this is how my hand looks like this. So this is a melanocyte actually. So the purpose of this melanocyte is to produce the melanin pigment. Melanin pigment, I have told you what is the importance of this melanin pigment. Right, so these have got melanosomes. These melanosomes, see, first of all, this has got a nucleus. Then we have got the ER. This is, when it is, ribosomes are attached to the ER, then it is rough ER, RER, right? Then we have got the Golgi apparatus here. So, I actually need a bigger board and a good camera. I keep on shooting from the phone, no? So that is why I cannot use the big board. So So what happens here, if you guys can see, we have got the Golgi apparatus, right? So this Golgi apparatus, what is the purpose of Golgi apparatus? Golgi apparatus is like a cab services. It is going to take the particular thing and drop it somewhere. So in form of vesicles, right? So these cabs, I'm going to draw a cab, okay? So these cab is are the vesicles. So this cab is the vesicle. It is going to take the melanin pigment when the it is manufactured in the nucleus. It is going to go it, and it is packed in case of in form of these melanosomes. These melanosomes are going into dendrite, and this cab is going to release it, and thereby the melanin pigment is released. So we have studied three kind of cells till now. I know that it is being we are getting a little bit lengthier, but I want you, because once you your concept are clear, you can actually correlate with diseases. So we have got three kind of cells. One are the keratinocytes, which are the black color. Now these are the majority of the cells, you can see, right? These are going to do the protection work. In between we have got the Langerhans cells, the melanocytes, and one more kind of cells we have got are the Merkel cells. So these Merkel cells, you know, you can always remember it. They are like mare hue. Merkel, it is like, you know, dead Merkel. Okay, it is not going. So let's hope that our board is not damaged. So we have got one more kind of cells. Okay, these are the Merkel cells. Now these cells, they have got some special power. These, they have got some special power. They can release neurotransmitters. So what happens? They can actually release neurotransmitters. So they are going to, they are associated with a nerve terminal. So I'm going to make a nerve terminal here with a rate. So this is the nerve terminal which is coming, and which are closely approximated to the nerve terminal. So these Merkel cells, or we can also say that Merkel Ranvier cells, these are associated with the somatosensory nerve fiber. So what are the somatic sensory nerve fiber? All the sensations we are talking about. So there are a slowly adapting type 1 afferent fiber, which are coming from the nerve terminal. So we have got a fibers. So they have got neurotransmitter in them. So we are going to cover in the physiology everything when I am teaching you the nerve. So what happens, for time being, you remember that these Merkel cells, they have got, they are associated with the nerve ending. See, these nerve ending are the ending for sensory. See, there are two kind of senses. One is the sensory, another one is the motor. So sensory is basically which take up all the senses. Suppose I pinch you here, ah, it is painful. So that is a sensory. Motor is when I'm chewing. So there is also action of muscle of mastication which is happening. So muscle of mastication is contracting, relaxing, like that kind of sensation, which is related to the muscle. You can always remember that M for motor, M for muscle. Right. So this is again the third kind of cell is the Merkel cells. So these have got the neurotransmitter for serotonin, for ATP, for glutamate, not for ACH. Acetylcholine, which we have always talked about, not for this. So very small, they have got for small molecules, like for inotropic receptors they have got, right? So these are about the epithelial cells. Now let's talk about the basement membrane. We are going little bit down. So in the basement membrane, see, I'm going to take a section of the basement membrane. So we have got four layers of cells. So the first one is the basal layer. Basal layer, we also call it the granulomatosum. Germinating things are germinating. So germinativum, right? So this is the germinativum. So here, when the basal cells are there, I'm going to make a basal cell. What happens? We have got a basement membrane. Below that is the connective tissue, right? So this basement membrane also, we are going to look, observe little bit carefully. So in the basement membrane, we have got two things. One part of the basement membrane, which is towards the epithelium. One part which is towards the connective tissue. So I'm going to draw it. One from the blue, another one from the red. Red, why I'm going red? Because down in the connective tissue, we have got the blood vessels, right? So the part which is towards the connective tissue, we call it lamina densa, which is towards the basement membrane, which is towards the basal cell, we call it lamina lucida. Now you will be like, ma'am, we do not remember, we cannot remember it. Right now we'll remember it, but later on we'll forget. So always remember that connective tissue has got blood vessels, fibroblast. So it is a very dense layer. So the part of basement membrane which is towards the dense layer is the lamina densa part, right? So this is the lamina densa, which is in the bottom layer. In the lamina densa, we have got, in between is the proteoglycan. So proteoglycan is basically a glue which is connecting in the body also. Whenever you want to stick something with another and you do not have anything else like desmosome, hemidesmosome, so you're just going to put the proteoglycans, okay? So there are proteoglycans. Here also we have proteoglycans. Above also we have got proteoglycans. Below also we have got proteoglycans. Okay, so this is basically the glue. Now what do we see? We see that here in the densa layer, there are some very beautiful crystals are present. Beautiful crystals. Okay, so this is not one layer. This is like they are arranged. So I'm going to make it a little bit broader. So this part is our, see, I know that you will be telling, ma'am, it is this is way too much for NEET and all, but you have to stay here with me, because once we are done with the basic things, then we can actually easily correlate with the diseases. So what happens? This particular box, beautiful box, is our type 4 collagen. Then we have got a proteoglycan here, right? Then we have got a proteoglycan. And what happens? There are ropes. There are braided ropes. Like braided, like how should I show you? If you can see, this is a kind of a braid, right? So like braids. Like that, braids. So these braided part is coming, going from the collagen type 4, going into the connective tissue and coming back into the collagen, and there, this is how it is binding the, it is binding the basement membrane to the connective tissue. And what is it? This is type 7 collagen. So type 7 collagen, it is intermingled with the type 4 collagen, going down in the connective tissue, coming back again in the basement membrane, and this is how it is sticking the basement membrane. So you know what, it is like a garlet, it is like a necklace. Okay, so above layer we have got the lamina lucida. Lamina lucida, there is nothing more, it is just that we have got the proteoglycan. Up also we have got proteoglycan. Below also we have got proteoglycan. Which proteoglycan? Which is our BP. So BP is which whiskey? That is, actually it is Bulles Pamphrigoid, but it is some whiskey. I don't remember which whiskey it is. Okay, forget it. So this whiskey is, which whiskey it is? So it is 230 and 180. So the smaller one comes in 180 rupees, bigger one comes in the 230 rupees. So you can always remember it, that 180 and 230. BP, okay, forget it. I don't remember. So this is, or if you remember, you can comment in the comment section below. So this is the connection. This is a proteoglycan, okay. And in the Bulles Pamphrigoid, we have studied in the oral pathology. In the Bulles Pamphrigoid, there is, what is there in the Bulles Pamphrigoid? So this BP antigen is broken. This proteoglycan layer is broken, and because of that, the epithelial layer is detached from the mucous membrane, my dear friends. If you remember Bulles Pamphrigoid, what was the difference between pemphigus vulgaris and pemphigoid? Pemphigus vulgaris, there was a cleft between the cells. So there was intraepithelial cleft, right? Right? Suprabasilar cleft. So above the basilar layer, it was a cleft here. But in the Bulles, in the pemphigoid, what we have studied, epithelial detaches from the connective tissue because this antigen is broken. right? In between we have got just a protein, which is the laminin protein. So this is basically a structure of the basement membrane. Now the question that can be asked from the structure of, I'm gonna rub it. So the which can be asked is, first of all, lot of times question have been asking from the type of collagen, right? We are not going to cover the type of collagen in detail right now, but for time being we are going to cover just the, so the desmosomal connection, you know that it is between the two cells and attachment plaque is there. So that is, I think, much for NEET exam. There is not so much to remember, right? Also these keratinocytes, they have got keratin protein. So they are, these keratin protein, based on their weight, based on their isotropic number, based on their molecular weight, how much they weigh, okay? So like that we have got the numbering of the keratin protein. So this is like that K1, K2, okay? Then K10, K12, this protein, keratin protein, is seen in both ortho and parakeratinization, okay? Then we have got like that K6, K16. So you have to just write one above it. So 6 means what? Sixer. So always remember 6 is maximum, right? A maximum of how much can you score in a cricket is when you put a sixer, right? So like that you can remember maximum proliferation. Whenever there is a highly proliferative epithelium, so there is 6 and 16. So that is our junctional epithelium. Maximum proliferating is the junctional epithelium. I'm going to tell you that the rate at which these cells are going to renew themselves. So I'm going to tell you. So what happens? The maximum proliferation is junctional epithelium. So that is K6 and K16 will be present. Then K1, as you can see, K1 is the lightest molecular weight. So it is going to always present in the upper layer. Upper layer is our corneum layer. So K1 is the corneum. Then we have got, like that we have got also something which is present only in the parakeratinization, which is the K19. Also K19 is present in the parakeratinization. Also K19 is present in the bottommost layer, which is our basal layer. So K19 is a keratin protein which is present only in the parakeratin, not in the orthokeratin. So what is the difference between ortho and parakeratin? See, orthokeratin is completely keratinized. Orthokeratin will have the basal layer, spinosum layer, granulosum layer, corneum layer, lucidum layer. So all the layers will be present. But in case of parakeratin, there will not be corneum layer which is present. Okay, so this is basically difference between the layers. And how these keratin is released? Keratin is released in the granulosum layer. So what happens? What happens? Let's draw it once again. See, if you are not understanding anything, then you have to go back, watch the video, do it several times, read it, and still then if you are not getting it, then you can comment in the comment section. I'm going to tell it in some other video, the same thing, okay? So what happens? This is the basal layer. Upper we have got the spinosum layer. Upper we have got the broader and the huge cells, right? And the uppermost layer is the cells which are flat-like cells. So as we go from bottom to up, so the cell size is increasing and it is going more flatter. It is going more towards the flatter. So what happens? These basal layer cells, they are just going to form the keratinocytes. Yes, all the cells. They can just form the cells. They cannot form the keratin. As we go above, so what happens in case of spinosum layer? Actually, all the nucleus is present, all the organelles are present. So what happens? The spinosum layer, because we want to fill the keratin inside, right? So what happens? All the content, it starts getting into at the peripheries so that we get the space for the keratin. So like that, there is a pycnotic nucleus which is present at the periphery, right? In case of the spinosum layer. As we reach to the granulosum layer, so there is acid which is produced. So this acid actually degrade this nucleus which is present. So all of the cell, it becomes empty and the keratin is formed here. And it is released in the corneum layer. So this is how it is released. So we have got a granule of the keratin. We call it keratohyaline granules. And in these granules, there is filaggrin which is present. So this filaggrin is a precursor of keratin. So this filaggrin will later on stages will form the keratin. Okay, so this filaggrin is a precursor of the keratin. Like that we have got other precursor of the keratin. So like that we have got some more things, like we have got the keratolinin, like that we have got the involucrin. So all of these are going to form the keratin. I hope that now your doubts, your concept are clear. So this acid is acid phosphatase. So acid phosphatase is increased in the granulosum layer because it is going to destroy it, right? So we have got the first layer is our basal layer. Second layer we have got the spinosum layer. Spinosum layer we also call it prickle cells. So because these are what spines, like the prickles, like so like that you can remember the prickle cells or the cockle bur cell or the sticker cells. Above up if we go, we have got the granulosum layer. So granulosum layer is the granular layer. So you can remember the granular layer. Then the most uppermost layer is the corneum layer, which has got a corneocyte. I'm going to show you how corneocytes look like. See, this is a corneocyte, okay? In this corneocyte, we have got the filaggrin. Filaggrin, which color we draw? Last time, I think we drew from the blue. Okay, let's draw it from the blue. So this is our filaggrin protein. Now this filaggrin is present, and also we have got, see, this is not the filaggrin, I'm so sorry. This particular red part, I'm going to tell you once again, hold on. So this is basically our corneocyte. Here we have got the tonofilament inside it. Tonofilament, and we have got the filaggrin, because the filaggrin is actually released here. So here we have got the filaggrin. So this is how the corneum layer. So we have also studied the cells. So cells we have studied that the keratinocyte. So principal cell type of the gingival epithelium is the keratinocyte. So always remember, we have been studying keratinocytes are the cells which I drew it from the black color. All the cells were mostly on the black color. So keratinocytes are the basic principal cells of the epithelium of the gingiva. First thing. Second thing, what are the other cells which are the non-keratinocytes? We have studied the Langerhans cells, the Merkel cells, the melanocytes. So melanocytes are present in the basal as well as in the spinosum layer, right? Then we have studied the Langerhans cells. Langerhans cells, if you remember, they were the present in the spinosum layer. So suprabasilar, above the basal layer. They have got the MHC class 2, which is the antigen presenting. I've told you the whole story there. So they help in the immunity, right? So and they have got the Birbeck granules also. So these Langerhans cells, they have got the Birbeck granules. What is the significance of these Birbeck granules? It is very interesting. How did I forget to tell you this? So what happens? This is a Langerhans cells, right? So this Langerhans cells, it has got some granules, okay? These Birbeck granules. So these granules are going to take the antigen out. So we have studied that two processes are there. One is the cell drinking, one is the cell vomiting. So we'll study that, phagocytosis and all, we are going to study in the pathology. So for time being, remember, if they want to take anything inside, then also this Birbeck granule plays role. If we want to take anything out of the cell, then also these Birbeck granules plays role. So we have got in the Langerhans cells, we have got the Birbeck granules. And the next cells we studied was the Merkel cells. These have got the receptors for the neuroreceptor for the sensory, somatosensory receptors, right? So these are the cells. Now talking about the junctional epithelium. Junctional epithelium, what is the thickness of the junctional epithelium? Thickness. We have studied in the last video. Yes, you know it. If you haven't watched the lecture, you haven't watched the first lecture, first part, and you're watching the second part. Okay, so let me tell you. This is 3 to 4 layer in the thick in case of adult. But in case of old age, once you see that older adults, that this is not working. So it has put on little bit of belly. It is a little bit thicker. So now it is adult, it was 2 to 3 to 4 layers. Exactly. then it is 20 layers. What is the length of the junctional epithelium? Where does it start? It starts at the cemento enamel junction or 1 millimeter above the cemento enamel junction. And what is the length? The length of the junctional epithelium, see, according to Carranza, it is 1.09 millimeters. But because I hope that because you are watching the NEET video, that means you are preparing for the NEET exam. So the range which is given in the dental pulse, it is 0.25 to 1.35 millimeters. Okay. So this is what you have to remember it. So this is 0.25 to 1.35 millimeters. It is the length of the junctional epithelium. Again, what happens once you probe it? Okay. Once you probe in the sulcus, suppose this is my probe, okay. Once you probe it, you are going to hit the gingival junctional epithelium. So you are going to give damage to the junctional epithelium. And you know what? This is the reason after the periosurgeries. I've told you in last video also. We do not probe it immediately. So we wait for 4 to 6 weeks before the healing happens, before the junctional epithelium is fully formed. And this is the common sense. What happens when there is an infection which is invaded? What happens when there is a pocket which is formed? See, I am telling you this several times. Now, when we are at the pocket video, we are at the pocket lecture, then please do not tell that, ma'am, how did it happen? See, this is the sulcus, okay? What happens if the sulcular depth is more than, see, this is the depth. Sulcular depth is up to the marginal gingiva, right? It is going to be this much. Okay, let's take this pen. Suppose this much. So, it is up till the marginal gingiva. That means it is going to be this much. So, this is 2 to 3 millimeters if I tell normal sulcular depth. Okay. What happens in case of pocket? I am telling that the depth increases. That means it is going to be a little bit wider. So, once I see now the marginal gingiva is up till here. That means this much is the depth of the sulcus. Right? This much is the depth of the sulcus. That means the depth increases. Now, what happens? Earlier, there was a junctional epithelium. Suppose up till here. We are going to go a little bit below. This is the bone. What happens now that the pocket is increased? The junctional epithelium is also reduced, as you can see. So, the length of the junctional epithelium, it is reduced in case of pocket. Right? This is the common sense. Now, you will never forget it that in case of pocket, the junctional epithelium is reduced in the size. Also, when there is an atresian, junctional epithelium migrates apically towards the root. See, what happens? The junctional epithelium, when the tooth is erupting, okay, it is at the CEJ. Usually, where it is? At the cemento enamel junction, right? So, what happens? It starts somewhere close to it, right? So, what happens when a tooth is erupting? It is at the enamel. When the tooth, during the eruption, it is going little bit apically, but once the tooth is fully erupted, it is at the cementum or at the CEJ. But what happens as the age progresses, there is going to be atresian of the teeth, right? So the teeth, they get start reducing from the incisal or the occlusal areas in simple words. So in case of atresian, in case of tooth wear, this junctional epithelium start migrating down apically, we call it, right? So, again, I am going to draw the diagram one more time. I think this diagram is by heart to you by now. So, this is the enamel. Here is the cementum. This is the marginal gingiva, free gingival groove, attached gingiva. So, how I am going to make? See, this is the normal gingiva. When I am telling you this sulcular gingiva is inflamed, then they are all going to be elongated basal layer. Okay. So, that we will study in the pocket. Now, I am making it straight. That means this is a normal looking gingiva. Okay. Then we have got the attached gingiva. We have got the retepigs. That is the reason for stippling. Then here is our mucogingival junction. This is the attached gingiva. Then we have got the marginal gingiva here, which is at the margin, which is the free. This is the free gingival groove, which is present in 50% of the cases. This particular part, little guy, little belly. This is the sulcus. Right. Here is the bone. Now, what happens? Starts from the CEJ. We are going to start from the CEJ. Little bit above from CEJ. Let's start. So, little bit above from the CEJ, we have got the junctional epithelium. Right? This is our junctional epithelium. So which the height of the junctional epithelium? Again, what is the height of the junctional or length of the junctional epithelium? It is 0.25 to 1.35 millimeter. How much is this? 0.25 to 1.35 millimeter. So 2535. Just add one. Add one ahead. Add one here. So 1. Point, so see, PDL also 0.25. Okay, just hold on, hold on. PDL also. Whenever you see the PDL, always remember PDLO. That is PDL. Okay, hour glass. This is the PDL. PDL also 0.25. So junctional epithelium start from 0.25, add one here, one here. So that is going to be 1.35. So 0.25 to 1.35, right? Easy to remember. Now what happens? This is the junctional epithelium. Starts from at the CJ or 1 millimeter above the CJ. Next, this is the crest of the bone here. Now, this starting of the junctional epithelium up till the crest of the bone, we call it biological width. This we have covered in the previous video. I'm not going to tell you right now the significance in the clinical practice, or I'm not going to tell you what it is. So this particular fellow, suppose it is 1.09. Again, I'm telling you this pulse, there is a variation in the in this length, okay? Pulse, it is written, something different is written, okay? But I am telling you what I have read from the Carranza, so you can follow the pulse. You will have to follow the pulse. For this measurement, do not follow me. Then what happens? This particular fellow is 1 millimeter. So this is from the junctional epithelium up to the crest. Here we have got the connective tissue, right? So this is the connective tissue attachment. So biological width is equal to junctional epithelium plus connective tissue attachment, which is 1 millimeter. So this is going to be 1.09 plus 1, that will be 2.09. Again, you have to refer for this for pulse. I am telling you what I have studied from the Carranza, okay? So you can refer from the pulse. So the gingival fibers, here we have got the gingival fibers and the junctional epithelium. This unit we call it the dento-gingival unit. So dento is the junctional epithelium, the epithelium which is attached to the teeth, and the fibers which are coming for the gingiva, we call it the whole of the fibers, we call it the dento-gingival unit, right? So I was telling you the turnover rate, right? So what happens, this junctional epithelium, we are not going in detail in about junctional epithelium. If you want to watch the in detail lecture, then you can go back and watch the perio series, in that you will find the lectures from the Carranza. So talking about the turnover rate is basically how it is dividing. So how it is dividing, how the gingival epithelium is renewing itself. So what happens, as I told you, the upper layer, it keep on shedding. So the new layers are keep on coming from the basal cell, from the basal layer. So the people who are towards the city, they are taking up people, hiring for army and sending up to the upper layer. Those who are weak, they are sending it to the upper layer, because anyways upper layer cell are going to lie down, right? So what happens, whoever is going from the upper layer, from below we are sending more people. So that is how the thickness is maintained, right? So this is a kind of a mitotic activity from below which is happening, right? So what happens, this activity is most in the morning, and least in the evening. So higher in the non-keratinized. Why higher in the non-keratinized epithelium now? Why I am telling you higher in the non-keratinized? Because common sense, keratinocytes are the cells which are going to do the protection work. When we do not have army, then what we do? We take people from the city, we tell them, now this is the high time, now this is a high alert, now you have to perform the role of the army people. Now the civilians, they get dressed in the army people, they fight for the country. Now the army people, they are well trained, so we do not require much of them. But the civilians are not very well trained, so we need lot of people. So that is how you can remember that the non-keratinized epithelium, we require more in number in case of non-keratinized epithelium for the purpose of protection. So also this renewable, it increases in the gingivitis also. So talking about the turnover rate means how frequently the new cells are coming. Okay, so junctional epithelium, you remember I told you this is the most proliferative epithelium when I was telling you about the which K 6 6. Remember I told you maximum you can score K6 and K16. So this junctional epithelium, that time I told you, is the most proliferative epithelium. So it is going to proliferate in 6 days. You can remember 1 to 6 days. Very easy. 1 to 6 days. Very easy. Always remember K16, 1 to 6 days. Then the palate can proliferate in 5 to 6 days. Palate also high proliferative. And if you remember, when we take the graft, so always we take graft from the palate only. So because this is a high proliferative epithelium. Okay, then gingiva proliferation is slow. It is very slow, 10 to 12 days. Like how you prepare for your exam, no, like that. Very slow, slow, slow. Ma'am, you only prepare for us. We do not want to do anything. You only put lectures for us. We do not want to do anything, right? So like that. GCF, bachche, we are not going to cover right now. GCF will cover in another video. So collagen, I'm sorry, yes, collagen. I forgot to tell you that. Collagen, which kind of collagen is present? So you can remember all halls ab base mein. That means all the halls are usually present in the basement, right? So ab base mein. So you can remember all, that means the type 1 collagen. So type 1 collagen is found in all the tissues. Skin, bone, dentin, cementum, blood vessels, all of the tissues. Right? So the structures are type 1 collagen. Hall, H-A-Y, hall, hyaline cartilage. So that is hyaline cartilage. And hyaline cartilage, you have to remember, all the cartilage is also type 2 collagen is there. Type 3, ab. Okay, I know it is a bit Hindi for those who speak English. I know it is a difficult, but every time making a new mnemonic, it is very difficult for me to like for everything I come up with a mnemonic, and it is difficult for me every time to come up with English. So it's better if you can remember in Hindi, or otherwise you can make a new mnemonic for yourself and you can comment in the comment section below so that others can also learn from you. So type 3, we are going to talk about ab. A for the arterioles. So or the arterial walls or the cardiac, all these have got the type 3 collagen. Then we have got 4. 4 is the basement membrane, base from basement. And me is the plasma membrane or the cell membrane, you can say, which is our type 5. So these are the collagens. Collagens also we are going to cover separately in some other video. So coming to the last topic finally of the gingiva, which is the gingival fibers. I know that it's a bit lengthy video, but my lovely friends, you are not going to forget anything. Gingiva is very important, because now that we have understood the whole of the gingiva, it is easy for us to understand the pocket. It is easy for us to understand the gingivitis and everything. Again, the same diagram, my lovely students, we have got here. Now, I'm going to rub it all, okay? I'm going to make two structures. One from the side section and one I'm going to make from the upper view. So, we have got two kind of fibers in the gingiva. One is the principal fibers, another one are the secondary fibers, okay? So, this is our marginal gingiva. Then we have got free gingival groove, then the attached gingiva, right? So this is our attached gingiva. Then we have got the cellular epithelium. Now, here is the bone. So here is our bone. Alright. Now the types of fiber. First of all, we'll start from the teeth. So whatever fibers which are starting from the teeth, we'll use word dento. We'll use word dento. Anyways, I'm going to plan for using these sketch colors. So I'm going to use the word dento. So which is coming from the dental, from the teeth, is our dento. So dento gingival fibers are the fiber which are coming from the teeth and going up to the gingiva. So these are our dento gingival fibers. I hope that you guys can see it clearly. Then we have got the fibers which are coming from the teeth and which are going into the bone. So bone is what? Alveolar crest. So which are coming into the alveolus. So these are our dentoperiosteal. Periosteum of the bone, right? So these are our dentoperiosteal fibers. Then we have got the fibers which are coming from the crest of the bone and up to the gingiva. Then these fibers are our alveolo-gingival fibers. So these are our alveolo gingival fibers. So coming from the alveolar, going towards the gingiva. Then we have got a kind of fibers which you cannot see it because you have to cut the teeth. So these are the circular fibers, okay, which are encircling the tooth in a collar like fashion. So these are the circular. So I'm just gonna make dot for the circular fibers, right? So, and the last one we have got are the transeptal. So suppose these are the two teeth. This is the interdental gingiva. Then we have got the crest in between. So here is the transeptal between the two teeth which are present, right? So in septum, present in the septum. So the green one we have drawn starting from the teeth up to the gingiva. What is it? Dento and gingiva, dento gingival fibers. Then we have got one in the orange. So that are coming from the teeth going into the alveolar crest. So dento periosteal fibers. Then we have got the one coming from the periosteum or alveolar ridge and going up to the gingiva. So this is the this is the alveolo gingival fibers. Then we have got the circular and the transeptal. These are the principal fibers. Very easy. Next, coming to the next one is, I'm going to take a upper section, okay? That means this is our one teeth. This one is our another teeth. Okay, molar suppose. Then we are taking section. That means we have to make the pulp chamber like that. Then one more teeth. Okay, here is our gingiva, gums. Suppose this is the buccal area, this is the lingual, it doesn't even matter actually. So, if I am making this retipex, now what gingiva it is? This is attached gingiva, my lovely students, we know that up by now. If we are talking about normal, then it is only the attached gingiva because this is the reason for stippling. So we are going to cover one by one. Now these are the principal fibers, these are the secondary fibers. Secondary fibers, first fiber which we are going to talk about is the intergingival fibers. So intergingival fibers are the fiber which are present in the gingiva. So these are our intergingival fibers, okay? So which are present in the gingiva. Next one we have the in the papilla. So in the papilla we have got, this is the papilla, interdental papilla, upper section, okay? From side of it is going to be the papilla between the teeth, right? So in the papilla is our interpapillary fibers. These are the interpapillary fibers. Then we have got a fiber which are coming and surrounding each and every teeth in a snake like manner. So these are the, like this. Like this. These are our transgingival. Okay. Transgingival. Transstructure, always we make it like that only. So these are the transgingivals. Okay. Transgingival fibers. Then we have got one which is in a circle like manner. So how do you make a circle? We have to make a circle like this. So these are the intracircular. Then we have got semicircular. That means we are going to cut the circle. So how do you cut the circle in half? Cut the circle in half like this. So these are the semicircular. So these are the secondary fibers. One more is there. Periosteal fiber is there. Actually, periosteal fiber is like from here, the periosteum up to the gingiva. Like that it will be periosteal fibers. So the secondary fiber, the periosteal fiber. Then we have got the intergingival fiber. Then we have got the intercircular, semicircular fibers. Then is the intercircular fiber. Then are the transgingival fibers and the interpapillary fibers. I hope that now you know what are the principal fibers. Now you know what are the secondary fibers. The blood supply is the periosteum. Nerve supply, we have got two types. One is the Meissner's type and one is the Croce's type. So Croce's type are end bulbs which are for the temperature. Croce and Meissner. Meissner, always we know the tactile sensation. So stippling, the reason for stippling is the retipex again. So where retipex are present? Marginal gingiva. So it is not present in the, attached gingiva. Why do I keep on telling the marginal gingiva? Stippling is present in the attached gingiva, right? Not in the marginal gingiva. Because attached gingiva, we have got the retipex. I am sorry if previously I have mentioned anywhere Stippling is present in the attached gingiva because there are retepigs. So, but this stippling, you can see it like the mountains. You know, these are the mountains. Who cannot climb mountain? The old people and the small kids. So, 5 years, less than 5 years, infant, they do not have the retepigs. And the old age, they do not have retepigs. So, one more important thing which I want to tell you is that oxygen consumption of normal gingiva, how much it is. This you have to remember it, my lovely students, 1.6 plus minus 0.3. This is the oxygen consumption. As the age increases, so the keratinization of the gingiva decreases. How? Because as we grow older, the tendency to fight the microorganism also increases. So always remember, keratinization is for protection. So the protection level decreases. That means the keratinization decreases. Width of attached gingiva is also decreased. See, attached gingiva is attached to the bone. So always remember that whenever you have the decrease of the bone, so there is going to be all the things which are associated with the bone. So when there is a decrease in the bone height, also there will be decrease in the attached gingiva. So the number of collagen fiber are also decreased, right? So guys, this is about the gingiva. I hope that you have enjoyed the video and you have understood it well. So this is about the gingiva. I hope that you have enjoyed the video again. So if you've enjoyed the video, give it a thumbs up. Also, you can comment in the comment section below. There is a link in the description box below to support me on Paytm as well as on PayPal to make free videos for you guys and to make free notes. So till then, keep reading, keep learning, solve questions, stay motivated. I will see you soon in the next video.